Good morning, and welcome to Conversations in Christ. We invite you to sit back, open your Bible, and engage in a dialogue as we learn together more about the incredible gift of grace that God has given all of us. Now, let's reason together in love.
Good morning, Donna.
Good morning, Billy.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, Carl.
Bill.
Carl.
Bill and Carl. There used to be a guy named Bill Carl.
Yeah.
He was a singer when I was a kid.
Was he?
Yeah. So we're in good company.
Good. Generally. And good morning to everybody out there.
Yes. Good morning, everyone.
Okay. And I think you were going to talk about the
success. I just wanted to give an update on that Julie Ferwarda book called The Raising Hell. And it's she just did a lot of research on the doctrine of hell in the modern church, hell and damnation and all that stuff. And church history, the words in the Greek New Testament, just common sense and reason, which God says, come reason together with me about your salvation. Though your sins be as crimson, they can be white as snow. So God's a reasonable God, and he's given us reason abilities. And so sometimes Christians want to throw out the reason part and just go, I'm just going to blindly trust somebody or a book or whatever. And I think God wants us to be rational, reasonable beings that he made us to be. So it's okay to think it through. It's okay to question. I don't think God minds that, depending on where your heart is. But I wanted to give an update. We offered this book that she wrote. It's a little skinny 100-page book, reduction of her bigger work. And it's been well received. I've been able to give a number of amount. I had a friend say, hey, why don't you give me some extras? I'll give them out. And then a lady here in town, she read one and she came back, said, I'd like a couple more. And then she wrote to me and said, make it five. And so I left those for her at a coffee shop where she could pick them up. And then we had somebody contact us from Washington. And they said, is 15 books too many? I go, nope, we got plenty. So anyway, it's getting out there. I think it's a really good, well-written, easy to understand, accurate, thorough book. I couldn't write anything better. That's why, you know, I just hand it out and let people. So it serves as a means for people to read and check into this subject and make up their own mind. I know a lot of people are going to believe that God has to punish sin eternally and torment people forever. I don't think that's in his nature. I think just the opposite. He wants people saved, and he's never going to give up until they are. He's never going to abandon his desire for everyone to be saved. He came into the world to save sinners. He didn't come to condemn it. I mean, just everything in the New Testament says this is a God who doesn't change. I want people saved, and by golly, I'm going to do it. I'm going to accomplish that. So that's kind of the basis of the book. So if anybody wants one, we got contact information on conversationsinchrist.net. Just give me a call. I'll meet you in town, give you one. I'll bring one to your house, you know, mail one to you, whatever works.
I just thought since it's almost spontaneously taking off, where there's these small groups that are starting to develop.
Oh, all over the world.
Yeah, with this book or with this material. So.
Oh, she's maybe only one of many, yeah.
It would be nice to maybe to start a small group here in the Grass Valley, Nevada City area, and go through, because it's a book that it's worth having a conversation over.
Yeah.
And explore ideas and ask questions.
Yeah. It's not a mean book. She's a very kind, loving person. She's a nurse. And the way she got started, her daughter approached her and said, Mom, something's wrong with this. And so she gave her all the stock answers, like all of us do. And then she got thinking, maybe I need to look into this. And she did. And I had done the same thing. Actually, Mike prompted me originally. Mm-hmm. And I started looking into stuff, and I dug into church history and everything, and I go, something's wrong here. This doesn't make sense for who God is and who he's presented to be in the New Testament as the God of high moral excellence and a God who loves his world and a God who sets his mind on doing something, coming into the world to save sinners and desiring no one to be lost. He's going to accomplish that, whatever it takes, however long it takes. That's just consistent with who he is.
Yeah, when you think about, when you really understand God's grace and mercy, it just does not jive with hell.
It really doesn't.
It doesn't at all. It never resonated with me 50 years ago. Yeah. I'm going, I can't even think about that. It doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah. Well, there's a couple of things that happen. First of all, whatever you're taught your whole life, it seems right because you've heard it over and over and over and over and over, and I did too. And if that's all you hear, and you never hear anything else, that's going to seem right because you heard it so much and because it's all you've heard. Mm-hmm. So when you bust through that and examine everything carefully, as Paul tells us to do, all of a sudden, well, wait a minute, there's more facts here. Let me think this through. So,
my early years, I was raised in a Nazarene church just like Julie was, and I had more fear than anything, and that dominated.
Oh, yeah.
That dominated everything that I did, even though I rebelled against it and, kept asking questions, but it sure made me kind of, it took the joy.
It does.
It took
does
the joy, and I
or at
think
least
it,
diminishes.
And I feel like it held me back, in learning and all kinds of things, you know. And being free of that just opened up a whole new world.
Well, and it's such an embarrassing message when you say, God loves unconditionally. Oh, by the way, well, He may not with you.
Right. Right.
Remember, I pulled that with my sister when I was 30.
Yeah.
And she'd come to me and she said, hey, do you think based on my behavior, I'm going to be going to hell? And I said, sure enough, you're going to be going to hell.
That's right.
And of course, that was the way I was taught. Now, I apologized a couple months ago when I was on the phone talking with her.
Right.
And she was asking me about our radio program and kind of what we emphasized.
Yeah.
And I said, geez, I don't even remember that day.
Well, what's happened is we've historically for the last 1,500 years, not 2,000, we've turned the good news into a threat.
Right.
And when you threaten people with hell and damnation, you instill fear in them. Now, a lot of them go, I'm out of here. And that's why a lot of people have rejected God and rejected the good news, because we've turned it into a threat message instead of an announcement. The word evangelical or evangel, good news, means to announce a victory won.
That's right.
Already, it's an announcement. It's not a threat. It's not even an offer. Hey, tell you what, I'll make a deal with you. You come and believe the right thing, and I won't do the worst possible thing anyone could ever do to anyone forever against you. You can alleviate yourself from that by you doing something. Yeah, Christ died on the cross, that's good, but guess what? The bottom line is what you do. And see, there's a lot of power in that, in that kind of message of threatening people. The Catholic Church did it for centuries. They owned people through fear and guilt. And I got the same thing when I was raised in a really good church, and I'm glad that it restrained me. I was a very careful as a guy in Vietnam. I didn't screw around, didn't take drugs.
It kept you
my
safe.
My background was good in that sense, but it did rob me of a lot of joy and living and enjoying life, because I was always living under the, I kept re-upping with God. If I didn't mean it last time, I do this. I believe now, God. Because I believe my belief, my act of belief is what saved me, not Jesus on the cross. He saved me. I don't save myself by believing, and He just sets it up. So getting free from that and saying, wow, my salvation depends on Jesus alone. And whether I accept it or not is going to affect how I live and how God's going to deal with me. But He's not a retaliating God who says, if you don't have the right attitude, I'm going to retaliate against you, pure retaliation with no correction forever. I'm not even going to give you any more. There's no more grace. There's no more love. There's no more. I'm done with you. And that's what you said. That's not the character of God. It's not what you see in the New Testament. It's not the God, the Father that Jesus knows. Might be the God of the Old Testament to some degree, but when it comes down to Jesus versus the Old Testament, I'm going with Jesus, the gold standard of love and bringing us into fellowship with the Father. You never have anything like that really in the Old Testament.
Possibilities and the view of what you can do in this life become limitless. It's so enjoyable.
Yeah. And you know, and it's that irreconcilable side of God that says, well, this doesn't make any logical sense to me. Because just as you were pointing out, Carl, that, oh, God's just going to be done with us. He's, you know, tried that for a little bit, didn't work. So now, you know, I'm going to create this place called hell where there's this ongoing torment, fiery furnace, whatever you want to call it, but certainly separation and pain and sorrow away from me. And I'm going to put you in that forever. What doesn't make any sense is this life is so temporal. You know, we've got 80 years to try to figure this out. And you're saying, I gave it a try. It didn't work. I gave you your 80 years. So now I'm going to give you all of eternity away from me.
Your time is up. I'm gonna retaliate against you forever and do the worst possible thing anyone could do to anyone. Come on, folks.
You know, I was wondering when you were talking about what you said to your sister about hell. What did that do to your relationship with her?
She never talked about it. So, you know.
Oh, wow. Yeah. She just held that in all those years. Yeah.
So when you brought up, when we're delivering this message, you say, well, there's some people that want to talk about it and accept it, and then there's some people that just want to run away and do their thing. Well, that running away for them is a way for self-defense, to hide.
Yeah, sure.
They want to hide from God. Of course, they want to hide from you, too, because you brought this terrible message. But the main person that they want to hide from is God.
Well, and they're hiding from a God that doesn't exist. That's why when people tell me they're an atheist and I ask them why, and they explain it to me, I go, well, then I'm an atheist too.
Sure.
Because I don't believe in that God either. Mm-hmm. I remember Bertrand Russell wrote a book, Why I'm Not a Christian, although it has a lot of issues in it. Actually, I read it and I go, I'm not that kind of Christian either. You know, because he was describing all the flaws in Christianity, you know, all the mean-spirited retaliation and the stuff from the Old Testament and what happened in the church in the Middle Ages and everything. I'm going, guy's done his homework. That's not the God we know. It really isn't. Mm-hmm. But it's the God we've been taught. And man, to come to the realization that God is a wonderful Savior, who saves and redeems and restores and didn't come into the world to condemn it, but to save it, and by golly, he's going to do it. That changes your whole attitude toward him. He's bigger than ever. Your attitude toward other people.
Yes, it does.
I don't condescend them. Oh, we're in the in group and you're going to go to hell because you don't go to my church. All that goes away. And now I can have conversation with just about anybody. Same-sex people, mm-hmm. Muslims, Buddhists. I talk to anybody. I don't agree with them completely, but I can talk with them. I don't feel like I got to put the whammy on them or isolate myself. I don't want to talk to those heretics. No, I want to talk to you because you're my brother and sister in humanity, and God loves you, and I want you to know about his grace. He loves you. He's never going to leave you or forsake you. That's what I tell the people at the assisted living when I quit playing. I say, you're going over the rainbow someday. A lot of them look, I don't know. Yeah. I said, yeah, you are. Because God doesn't make junk and he's not going to throw you away. You are of infinite value to him. He loves you so much. You can put your trust in him. See, faith is there. We believe because he saved us. We don't get saved because we believe. We get it backwards, I think. That's just my take on who God is.
Yeah, that's why I've come up with this theory. One way to get rid of all the world religions out there and get rid of all the different 32,000 different denominations, it comes down to two things. God has saved everybody, and there's no place called hell.
Mm-hmm.
That takes care of everything.
It does.
It does.
It eliminates all the disunity, and if we could do that...
We're not separating ourselves from each other.
No, and we wouldn't be fighting with one another.
Those two things... Bill, are a terrible heresy to some people. I've been called a heretic, false teacher.
Oh, yeah.
That's a compliment.
But at the same, I suppose, but at the same time, I respect the fact that that's where they are. It's where I was. Mm-hmm. And when I didn't look into everything, I kept telling people, look, I want to present all the facts, and you can do whatever you want with them. I just want to get all the facts out there. you go in a lot of settings and they carefully control the narrative and the information and everything because they're afraid of telling people everything. And when you got a doctrine like this, which is like having a crazy uncle in the basement that you don't want anybody to know about, they never talk about it. But boy, if you don't believe it, you are not believing everything about God.
But what they're really saying, if you think about it, is to be saved, you must believe in hell.
Oh, yeah.
And
if you don't believe in hell, you're going to go there for a lot of people.
But that's crazy.
I think it is, but well, I don't want to call it crazy because everyone has a belief that they've inherited or decided on, and I want to respect that because I can be wrong.
But if the gospel is the good news, what is salvation based?
I might agree with you that idea is a little crazy, but I don't want to call them crazy because I know a lot of believers.
I didn't say they were crazy.
A lot of people believe in hell and damnation. It's what they've been taught, and they tie that in with the sovereignty of God. And if
salvation.
God is really going to be God, he can't let Hitler off the hook. I got a friend who, every time I get together with him, he mentions about, I can't go with this thing because of Hitler. And I haven't told him this yet. Maybe someday I will. Maybe he's listening. My question is not so much what do you think Hitler deserves. I would ask, what does he need? See, what does Hitler mm-hmm. need? Even right now, if he's somewhere and he's still a rebelling against God, what is his need? To be redeemed, to be saved, to know God. And the other question, the other half of it, is when we sin, whether you're Hitler or anybody else, what does it invoke in God? What does it make God want to do? It makes him want to save people. It doesn't make him, oh boy, I really want to do you in. No, he loves you and he goes, I don't want you under that horrible spell and binding of sin. I want to save you from it. And I don't think that desire in God ever goes away. He goes into eternity. Like I said, it's not time is up, you've died. No more Mr. Good Guy. I've gone from Dr. Jekyll the healer to Mr. Hyde, the mean, spirited retaliator. That's just not who he is.
No, and remember Jesus on the cross said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
They don't know what they're doing. Forgive them. Forgive them. I've forgiven you. The problem isn't with me being mad at you. The problem is you
they're not in
hiding
the right
from
mind.
Me.
Yeah, right. Yeah. But that's what
and I want to do
they're
something about that. See, love takes action. That's why judgment, I've always argued that judgment is God's love in action. I'm going to make an accurate assessment about you, and then I'm going to condemn sin in the flesh, and I'm going to condemn the old man that we're going to talk about eventually today and in the future.
Well, we'll tie it in with
the
these
old
next
person.
Verses in
Colossians. I'm going to condemn that and save you. That's my goal.
Let's tie them in the Colossians 1:19.
Okay.
Yeah, 1:19, second page. So people are probably out there going, well, where are you guys coming from? Why do you guys believe this? Well, we believe it to a certain degree because we think that's what Paul believed. And so when you look at Colossians chapter 1, which ties into our this new self, this is what the new self is living day in and day out, 24/7. Paul says in verse 19, for in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of the cross.
That's the bottom line. That's what he did on the cross.
Notice he doesn't say, I'm just going to reconcile some things.
Or the believers, or the elect, or the Jews, or no, I'm going to reconcile all things.
It was all done.
Myself. Mm-hmm. He repeats that in Ephesians, by the way.
Yeah, and you know, you studied a lot of church history. Wasn't this kind of the cornerstone?
They loved this stuff.
Yeah.
They over and over dwelled on these verses. They would say things like the early church before Roman Catholicism and Augustine, hell's going to be emptied. A lot of them believed there was a hell, but they go, God's going to empty hell someday. That's a place of correction because God always has that heart of correcting. If there's a hell, if there's a place that God sends people to, it has to be corrective in nature. Even the Jews believe this at the time of Christ. Very few of them believe that God may send a few people to hell forever, but they believed it was a 12-month period of correction, because that's who they see God to be, a God who came to correct and to save and to redeem and restore, not to condemn, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Paul says in verse 20, and through him to reconcile to himself all things. Well, if Jesus didn't reconcile all things to himself, then he failed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He either couldn't do it or didn't want to do it.
Because he clearly came to do that.
Yeah.
See, that's clear that his goal was to save humanity through Christ on the cross, the atonement of taking away the sin of the world. And he's the savior of all men, and he's the sacrifice not just for our sins, but for those of the whole world. It's very clear what his goal was. The question is, did he accomplish it? Or did he just give it the good old college try? And, well, I tried, but you know what? Free will thing has really gotten out of hand. So, you know what? I'll just give up. I'm done. I don't desire anybody to be saved anymore. That was the old me. Now I'm tired of this. No, never.
Well, I always want to ask people who believe in hell is, so when did God create hell, and how did he ever come up with that whole vision of creating a place with eternal torment, fiery furnaces, pain and suffering for all of eternity? How could an unconditionally loving God create something like that? And if he could create something like that, when did he do it? Because we know he created the world. We can see that in Genesis 2. So we see this creative power that he has. So point out in this book here, when did he create hell?
Oh, he got it ready way back when, just in case he needed it for some good purpose.
That was the trump card, man. Okay, yeah. I got this place before I even created heaven, before I even created the earth.
Yeah. And again, I can't say exactly what God's going to do in eternity. We tend to believe when people die that old self is annihilated. I believe in annihilation of the mm-hmm. old self, and that new person that's raised from the dead is going to be a new body, soul, perfect person that will live forever with God. That's the whole purpose of the salvation and the resurrection. But
believing in hell doesn't save you. That's all I was saying.
Believing in hell not believing?
Yeah, yeah. That's not what's...
Oh, yeah,
That doctrine.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, they tie it in with... Because they've got this good news message and they feel like it has no teeth. There's no bite to it if you don't have hell hanging over people's... But that's the way we've been treated. That's the way you were raised, I was raised. It's the way the church has been for 1,500 years, not 2,000.
It brings misery, though.
Yeah, but it brings bondage, crowd control, it brings in the
crowd
money,
control.
It brings in a lot of things, and it makes people live in guilt and fear.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the two things that I got freed from. Now, I am guilty of sin, that's true, but I don't live in guilt, and I don't have any fear. I don't fear God. Mm-hmm. He's a wonderful Savior.
But the guilt and fear brings money into those establishments.
Yeah, yeah, and it robs us of our joy, I can tell you that.
Absolutely.
I got robbed. I'm enjoying a more abundant life today as a 73-year-old mm-hmm. than I did in my middle ages,
mm-hmm.
raising my kids. I loved the Lord. I served him. I taught in the church. I did all those things. It was good, but it wasn't this good. It was not this good. This is, once you get here, you're home.
Mm-hmm.
There's no place else to go.
Yes.
There's no place else to go. You don't go back, and there's no higher place to go.
No.
You don't have to hope that God's better than whatever. I remember as a little kid thinking two things. When I was told hell at about 7 years old, I thought, that doesn't make sense that a loving God would send people to hell. And then I remember thinking, I hope we're wrong somehow. I hope my parents are wrong, but I didn't believe they were, and I went out and played baseball. I remember those two thoughts, and I think that's been in me. That's been in me all those years.
Sure, yeah. Sure.
I think we instinctively know God to be, he's got to be greater and better, and he's got to be infinite and unlimited in his power, ability, sovereignty, salvation, everything.
Yeah, and when you start to realize this ultimate worth that God has for every individual, we pick up on that. That becomes the fruit of our lives, too.
Oh,
now,
it does.
Now, every person that you interact with during the day has value.
Value. I was thinking worth. That,
they
yes.
They do.
You know,
yes.
You know, you're, whatever the situation is, you're going to be applying patience if you need to, but you're going to be loving them because mm-hmm. you know how much God loves them.
That's right.
Yeah, I used to just automatically condescend them. I go, oh, there's somebody in the restaurant. They're probably not, don't go to my church. They don't believe. They're going to go to hell, and that's what they deserve. And that's sad. That's a horrible, horrible way.
That's tough that you can even admit it, but I've lived there. We all have.
Please, you don't go back once you get free of that. So we hope folks out there will...
Know they're loved. Know you're loved.
I tell you, this is... It's amazing.
Yep.
It changes everything.
And that this is a part of your new creation.
It is.
Yep. Okay, well, we're out of time again. I don't know how we're ever going to get through all this, but we will. ConversationsInChrist.net is the website. And we're going to be on this new and old person mm-hmm. contrast from the New Testament for many weeks to come. So join us next week, folks. We love you. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to Conversations in Christ. Our prayer is that today's program has opened your heart and mind to a greater understanding and curiosity about the gift of grace that God has given to each of us in and through His Son, Jesus Christ. Remember, you have been blessed with every spiritual blessing by God, so that you may believe and begin to experience the very life of God in you. Tune in again next week for Conversations in Christ.
If you have a comment or a question, we would love to hear from you. You can contact us at conversationsinchrist.net. That's conversationsinchrist.net.